In the last section, we finally applied our first deployment to our local cluster. Now, just to make sure that everything is working the way we expect, I want to try to connect to the container inside of that pod running the multi-client image. And when we connect to it, we should see that little React application appear on the screen. So I want you very quickly to remember how we connect to our local cluster. We do not use localhost. We have to run that minikube IP command. Remember that minikube virtual machine that is our local node has its own IP, completely different from localhost. So we need to first run minikube IP. Once we get the IP address, we'll then make sure that we connect to the port that was associated with that service that we created, which was hard-coded to be 31515. So back at my terminal, I'll do minikube IP. There's the IP of my virtual machine. I'll copy it. I'll make a new tab inside my browser, and then I'll put on colon 31515, because again, that is the hard-coded port of our service. And then when I do so, I do in fact successfully see my application appear on the screen. Awesome. Now, this is actually going to be a really good time to start to understand why we use these service things. Like, why do we have to create that service object? Why were we not able before to just directly connect to one of our pods that was running the container that we care about? Well, now that we understand the idea behind deployments, understanding why we have to have these service things is going to make a lot more sense. So one thing I want to show you very quickly. Back over at your terminal, try running the command kubectl get pods, and then we're going to add on an argument here of dash o wide, like so. That's going to still get our list of pods, but it's going to append on a little bit of additional information. Now I'm going to zoom out here really quickly just so I can see this thing on a single line. There we go. Now I want you to notice how we now have these IP and node columns over on the right-hand side. Now the really important column to take notice of here is the IP column. Every single pod that we create gets its own IP address assigned to it. So when we just deployed our deployment just 2 seconds ago and that created a pod, it was randomly assigned an IP address of 172.1706. This is an IP address that is internal to our virtual machine. So you and I cannot visit that IP, or at least we cannot visit it very easily. It is an IP address that has been assigned to the pod inside of our node right here. Now, the interesting thing about that is that if this pod ever gets deleted, or if an additional one is created, or if for any reason the pod gets updated or changed in any way, shape, or form whatsoever, it's entirely possible that the pod might suddenly get a brand new IP address. So let's imagine that this pod right here has that IP address of something like, I don't know, the 172.001. We'll just kind of make up an IP address like so. So I want you to imagine if we figured out some way to connect our browser to a pod running directly inside of our node. Then inside of our browser, we would type in something like 172.001. And then we would probably want to connect to port 3000. So we'd probably put on colon 3000 or something like that. Now the problem starts to arise if we start to recreate this pod right here, because maybe we have to remake it because our configuration has changed on the deployment, or maybe the original pod crashed, or whatever reason it might be. And so we can imagine that maybe we have to create a second pod. And this one would get a randomly generated IP of something like 002. And then maybe this original pod gets deleted. Well, now we originally had that IP address of 172.0.0.1. That IP address is not going to work anymore, because the object or the pod associated with it just plain no longer exists. And so in order to access this pod right here, we would in theory now have to manually type in that 002, like so. Now, as you might guess, having to update the IP address all the time inside your browser in a development environment would definitely be a big pain. And that's why we make use of these service objects. The service is going to watch for every pod that matches its selector. Because remember, that service has a selector. If we look at client node port.yaml, it has the selector of component web. So the service is going to look for every pod with that selector and then automatically route traffic directly over to it. So that's why we make use of the service. These pods are coming and going all the time. They're getting deleted, they're getting recreated, and every time they potentially might get assigned a brand new IP address. The service is going to kind of abstract out that difficulty, and that's why we make use of these services anytime that we want to connect to one of our different pods. Okay, so hopefully that gives you a better idea of why we care about these service things. So let's take a quick pause right here, and we'll continue in the next section.